fight every day for. Number one, the debt and the spending are unsustainable. Unsustainable. We're spending money we don't have. And if you look at the numbers out to 2020, Medicare, Social Security, interest payments on the debt, based on revenue flow from 2020, there's nothing left. So what do you do about national security? What do you do about disaster relief? What do you do about other needs? We in this country need a balanced budget amendment. And we're going to get a balanced budget amendment because it is the will of the people that will move in that direction. I come from a state with a balanced budget amendment. Practically every state in America has a balanced budget amendment. It is the best safeguard against run-ups in spending. And this nation needs one. It isn't going to be easy, but we're going to have a president in the Oval Office who pushes and controls and moves us toward the point in time where we too can get a balanced budget amendment, where our percentage of GDP that we are spending on government is not 23 or 24%, but it is something that is affordable. Number two, and I've had people say, well, that sounds interesting. In fact, that sounds a little hokey, but to me, it's totally doable in this country. This hopeful, optimistic, problem-solving, can-do country, we need to launch a new industrial revolution in this country. You know what I mean? Industry, manufacturing, or percentage as a percentage of GDP, what are we, 10 or 11%? Remember I told you I was born in 1960? Way higher. So today we sit flat on our feet, wondering what tomorrow's gonna bring. And I'm here to tell you that we've had a few industrial revolutions in this country. And every time we face defeat, as the greatest generation did during the Depression and World Wars, we managed to get through it. We managed to find our sweet spot. We managed to get back on our feet. And as I travel around the country, I see these holdout skeletal remains of the last industrial revolution. And I'm thinking, I'll bet during the Great Depression, people were thinking, we're done. How on earth are we ever going to get back on our feet again? And you know what? We did. And I'm here to tell you, this country is going to get back on its feet again, too. But it's going to take three things, I do believe. And why do I say these three things? Because I governed a state. And I'm not going to give you theory. I'm not going to give you hot air. I'm just going to tell you what I did. And I'm going to draw from my own experiences. We need tax reform. You cannot have the second highest tax rate in the developed world and expect to attract money, capital, brain power, talent, entrepreneurs. It doesn't work. And so long as we're competing against a whole lot of others who are figuring out how to compete in the 21st century, we can't do it with a top-heavy tax code that has biases, that has loopholes, that has deductions that people just run away with. We can do better than that. We've got to reform our tax code. Number two, we've got to get the regulatory monkey off our back. I can't tell you how many visits I've had around this country recently where particularly small business folks say, you know, first of all, I can't get access to capital because of the ratio requirements these days. Other businesses would say, I'm not going to deploy capital in the marketplace. I can't figure out healthcare. I have no idea what it's going to cost my employees or me, and therefore I'm concerned about the future. How often do you hear about that? So if we're going to get this economy right, we need regulatory reform. Third, the lowest of low-hanging fruit, and we've been talking about it forever, but not quite taking it seriously, is energy independence. I'm here to tell you that for eight presidents, going all the way back to Richard Nixon, who stood up and said, 37% imported oil. This is a travesty. We can do better than that. We're never going to let it get beyond 37%. Only to have President Carter stand up and say, 40% imported oil. I'm going to create the Department of Energy to ensure that this never, never happens again. And here we sit today at 60% imported oil. And we are saying to ourselves, $4 a gallon, $4 and 50 cents a gallon, and we think that's real? Go take a look at what the Milken Institute in Los Angeles has to say about what it's really costing all of us for a gallon of gas. When you factor in deployments to the Middle East, when you factor in keeping the sea lanes open for the importation of imported oil, When you look at terminaling, storage, distribution cost, et cetera, it is $13 a gallon from what the analysts are saying. And I say, we ought to be outraged, and we can do it better in this country. You want to take a real cut at the trade imbalance, you want to do something that carries profoundly important national security implications, get imported oil down. And we can do it. We've got a product in this country called natural gas. And I met an entrepreneur in the northern part of Utah as governor, as I was tooling around visiting people in my suburban. And he said, I'd love to convert your suburban to natural gas. And I thought, you can do that? You can drive a natural gas car? I had no idea. I paid out of pocket. I had it converted. And you know what? People would call in and say, gee, I'm really tired, Mr. Governor, paying $4 a gallon for gasoline, as if the governor can somehow break up the cartel in the Middle East. And I say, let me tell you what I paid this morning for gasoline. I paid the equivalent of $1, natural gas. People started buying natural gas cars. It spawned a little revolution in our state, and I saw the power of what alternative fuels and natural gas can do in this country. It is ours, it is clean, it is cheap, and it has profoundly important national security implications. This is low-hanging fruit, and we should be seizing it. Fourth, let me tell you that it's time for the United States to pull out the map and to take a look at where we are, and whether or not where we are is consistent with our core national security needs. It's time to look at the map and say, where do we need to be? Who are our friends and allies? And what does it mean to be a friend and an ally of the United States? I'm not sure the world remembers exactly what it means to be a friend and an ally of the United States. And I'm here to tell you, as I mentioned before, we love our troops. We are totally, totally committed to our troops. One out of every six Department of Defense dollars going to Afghanistan. Listen, we routed the Taliban out of power. Karzai stood for free elections in 2004. Al-Qaeda was dismantled and set into Waziristan in western Pakistan. This is not a nation-building exercise, ladies and gentlemen. This is a counter-terror exercise. We don't need 100,000 troops on the ground at the cost we are paying today in order to get the job done.